Welcome, possibilitators of the possibilitator training.
Yay!
Yes! I invited Aunt Chloe and Clinton to have this training space and practice space, because possibilitator training being this incredible force that you've been playing and developing, and I've noticed that there are skills, a lot of skills that are needed in game world building, as to evolve the team, both the teams and people, about what could be the next step for each possibilitator and the possibilitator training itself, the whole game world itself. And so it seemed that we needed these 2 years or 2.5 years, maybe 3 years actually, to get to this point of evolving the whole game world to the next steps. And so I'm really glad that Clinton and Chloe accepted and that you are all here.
I just want to say that we've decided, with Clinton and I have decided, that our name is not Clinton and Aunt Chloe, but Aunt Chloe and Clinton. For future.
Yes.
First of all, this is a celebration, because I think it's the first cross region and cross specialty meeting we're having. Is that true?
Yes.
If you don't recognize some people, you can consider them your friends already. And you can talk to them anytime and say, I'm a possibilitator, and I have these questions, I have these pains, I have this celebration, or I want to collaborate with you. There used to be this tradition where there was a group of trainers kind of rotating in the possibilitator training, and it feels for me that I haven't seen you as part of the possibilitator training in a little while. And somehow I keep being like, I love being able to say there's a thing called the possibilitator training, and that there's all these specialties. I know this is not really the topic of this call, but I want to reignite this, that it is such a cool thing. It is such a cool thing that there's a thing called possibilitator training, that it's free, and that it's clear, that it's powerful, and that it's, that the space holders of each region and also each possibilitator, in my experience, have this demand of, I want this space to be alive, otherwise I don't show up. I mean, I don't know if you've ever had that experience of being like, I don't really want to go to the call because actually it's not so alive. But then you come back and saying, can we make this more alive? And I think this is really what this evolution of the possibilitator call here, for me, it's how do we keep having this conversation of what the possibilitator training is, so that it keeps being the most alive that they can be, and that we can be really in touch with reality as, like, how are we evolving? Like, each person is evolving in its own path, but also what is, I don't know, I can say it like that, like, what is the world need from us? Like, what is the kind of necessity that we are hearing and possibly answering? And somehow we've planned this call a couple of months ago, and somehow it happened to be now. And I think it's really perfect that it's now because of, for example, the proposal that Clinton made to the United Nations about this thing called the Archiarchy Invention Centers. So I don't know if you've read the article. There's also a couple of websites, Regenerate Earth Goals, that's the proposal, and the website, the Archiarchy Invention Centers, is also part of that proposal. And it's And basically the UN wrote a public letter saying, we're failing. Whatever we're doing, it's not working. And if we keep going, humanity will not have a place to live. I mean, they didn't put it in those words, but it was basically their message. And they were basically desperately saying, who has another solution? Because we've run out of what our mind can come up with. And so Clinton wrote out this proposal, which emerged from possibility management, but really also emerged from the possibilitator training and Bridge House, and the possibility of that there's people who can hold space for true non-material value, and especially transformation, initiation, and healing, which is often what the specialty of the possibilitator training are about. And so,
and yeah. You guys are potential space holders for Archiarchy Invention Centers. You are potential space holders for that. So just, I encourage you to look in the mirror tonight when you're brushing your teeth and go, look, there's a space holder for an Archiarchy Invention Center brushing their teeth. And that would help.
I mean, in a way, this would be a conversation about game world building. It's like, how do you move into the identity of being a game world builder? And something that I heard actually from Sonia when we were in the writing house together here in Bali, and Sonia, you were holding space for this creation team, this women's creation team with about 8 women around the world. And Sonia came on lunch or something and said, you know, what I realize is that women have this deep belief that they're not allowed to create. They're not allowed to be the one to set up something completely new that's not been invented before. To be a game world builder. And it was a shocking realization. But then I started having calls with edge workers, and I would have these game world conversations saying, you know, so there's many ways to have a game world building conversation, but we all got to the place where she said, the woman said, I mean, who am I? Who am I to take such a stand? Like, who am I to be so bold and to even invite other people into something I don't know how it goes? There's all these different fears. So somehow I would like this call to be about where are you? Like, where is your edge about maybe even considering that you are a game world builder and or a space holder for an Archiarchy Invention Center, a space holder for a specialty? Because, for example, I know that one of Clinton's specialties is to open territories and say, it is possible that possibility coaching exists. It is possible for Archiarchy Invention Center to exist. It is possible for possibility psychology to exist. It's possible for a possibility management documentary to exist. Like, there's all these territories that are available. At the same time, they only come into existence if it takes one person to hold space and say, I want this to exist. You know, I want this to shine. I want this to fly. And so basically we're looking at you as saying, what's your part where you're saying, I want this to exist and to be, you know, I don't know, available to the world, you know, in different languages. I want other people to be able to be trained in this.
Can I take a stand that this exists? Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd like to just add in an example that has come to existence sideways in the possibility management, in the possibilitator training game world, which is, you know, somehow we figured out to use Telegram as an emotional healing process support community where people from any of the trainings, even if they haven't been to Expand the Box training, can come in the group and offer or receive emotional healing processes. This is a platform to support each other, taking our steps along the path. what emerged sideways is that that platform is actually an environment for people to become trained as possibility coaches. And there's this now a procedure for a person to deliver 50 free emotional healing processes, 50 emotional healing processes at a certain price, and then get the qualifications to deliver emotional healing processes to the level of being a possibility coach, which is one of the specialties of the possibilitator training. And in addition to that, the platform of the emotional healing process, there's a second function. Can you explain it?
Yeah, which is actually in each specialty in Archiarchy, people need the skill. You need the skill, and the people in your specialty need the skill of delivering EHPs, because that's one of the main blocks to evolution or to growing up. You know, in addition to going through initiations, we know now that if we don't do the emotional healing process, the emotion will be there again and again and blocking a possibility.
So even though one of my main specialties, like I'm space holder for this Gameworld consulting specialty, is even though that has a particular set of skills and awarenesses to consult Gameworlds to shift to an archaearchal context, I still need the skills of emotional healing processes, which apply both to individuals and Gameworlds. And so I want to say that every one of the other specialties, whatever your specialty is, has a skill set, a new skill set that also needs to be supported or expanded. And so that's the series of specialties, this Gameworld that has this, qualities of Archiarchy as specialties that you get to source, the first people in the world kind of to source these specialties. This is an opportunity that's almost unimaginable. And yet it's really true. And so there's an ecstasy involved in taking a stand for being a space holder for a specialty that's unequaled in like the universe in a way, because it's just needed. It's so badly needed. And so many people are interested in this right now, even if they can't verbalize it, they can't ask their question intelligently, but this is what they want and this is what they need. And they want to learn a specialty for Archiarchy and hold space for it more than they want to go to the university, because what's offered through being in a specialty of a possibilitator specialty is far more valuable than any kind of a degree you could get from a university designed on last millennial values, the values that are exterminating life on Earth today. Yes, I got a doctor's degree in exterminating life on Earth. Okay, that's what you get from a university. And so what you're offering is so much more valuable and timely and precious than that. It's almost inexplicable. Yet that's really what's going on in this Gameworld. So I was up at 5:30 this morning, even though I went to bed at 11:30 last night, because I'm working on a project that's part of that. I mean, so I'm doing my thing, I'm doing my mimetic Thoughtware, my Thoughtware upgrade. I'm writing this book, the introduction and afterward from this Valerie Langford Four Feelings book, and it's just turning me on because it's my specialty. So I just wanted to share that. And I think I'm opening the floor to the same thing that Anne Chloe was opening the floor to, which is how about you? How's it going in your specialty?
I would add something while you're thinking about this, that basically the purpose for me of this call is to awaken the part of you that is a Gameworld builder, that you might not know that this part exists. And that part has different questions or considerations or view on the world or view even on a quote unquote problem or conflict in your team. It's also, for me, what it seems, it's a bigger perspective and also more of a practical one. And so somehow, if you can find this part of you and lower your numbness bar to it, like kind of bring it forward. And it, maybe it has fears, maybe it has questions, maybe it's like, where do I even start? You know, maybe that's what it's, that part says, like, I don't know how to even think about being a game world builder. That, yes.
I didn't get the last thing you said. I don't know.
Well, it's like, maybe the, what your experience of, your, maybe your experience of being a game world builder is, where do I even look for this part of me?
Hmm.
And what
I have.
No, I don't know.
You guys. Yeah.
Go ahead, Susanne.
What concerns me, or what I observe in me, is that the me perspective is still so very, very prominent, and that I somehow cannot come on or I'm really, to really embrace the big perspective. So really go out from this very small circle I can control, I'm comfortable with, I can interact, I know how it goes, so my box is comfortable with. So how to make the leap in this, what you are describing, being of service to the to humanity, it seems like a very big leap. And so what could be some next step to probably also overcome this self-centeredness?
So I don't know if it's the next step, but this is what happens, that I've seen a possible indicator is that you get bored. You get bored kind of delivering the same thing over and over to the same people who have the same problem. And it's like, okay, this is not feeding me anymore. I've heard, you know, I've heard it 100 times, and I'm interested in something else than what my client are bringing me or my participant are bringing me. And then there's this possibility, then this need of, God, what if I train other people in talking to where my clients are, so I can talk to other people where I want to, you know, where it's interesting for me, where I'm on my edge. And so how do you get bored? I mean, do you get what I'm saying, Susanne?
Yes,
about
how where it's actually already listening to, where am I bored? Where am I bored already? And I think I need to engage further. It's lowering my numbness bar against my boredom, which is already there. I can hear it.
There's this really cool hint, and I've said it before and I'll say it again because it's so exciting and remarkable, but it has to do with the labyrinth of spaces, the great labyrinth of spaces. And the clue is, the realization is, that every space is connected to every other space through the nothingness that's outside of the space, because the nothingness that's outside and distinguishes one space is the same nothingness that's outside and distinguishes every other space. And so the distance between life in service of your survival strategy and your box and your unconscious gremlin, the difference between that space and a space where you are being used by your bright principles and archetypal lineage to serve something greater than yourself and to be, you know, a creation force, the distance is this big between the one space and the other space. And so it's not a long distance to travel or a path where you have to work and work and work to get there. You can actually just go sideways out of your current space and try something different, like try the next thing. have a different conversation. Put yourself in a position of sourcing the next space. And it's, excuse me, it's very close. It is not a great distance. And each of you have this capacity by now to function. You all know this, where you speak from the unknown. You know what that feels like. You know what it feels like to, you know, establish a golden cube inside of which you're going to give a work talk. And you call in your bright principles, put a grounding cord on the golden cube. You look at the people in the work talk space and you commit to speak about what they need to hear, even if you've never heard it before, even if you don't know that it exists before. And when you're through that commitment to what they need to hear, their necessity, stuff comes through. How many people have had that experience? That's what I thought. That's what I thought. So you get to choose where you live. You get to live in a scarcity, survival-oriented, fearful, terrified, small, boring world of scarcity and low drama, you know, or you get to live in that space where something bigger than you is operating in your world. And so at first it seems scary. It could be scary. Okay, what is that source? What is its purpose? You know, what's going to happen to me next? What if I fail? What if I make a mistake? What if people question me and I don't have answers? You know, all these terrifying, deathly questions, you know, these horrible ego death questions that we have with us. You know, you can have all those questions, but you don't need to. So, because those resources that show up in the space that you're serving are bigger than you. They have more intelligence than you. You can start, so at first it's very scary, but in a short time, you can start radically relying on those sources showing up for you because they need you. If you're not there, they can't function in the world because they don't have a mouth or feet or eyes. You know, they don't have hands. They can't do what you can do. So they cannot function in the world without you. And they will support you in ways that anything from modern culture, not even a really big insurance policy, can serve you. Not $1 million in the bank can serve you. None of that. Even being famous on Instagram, it can't serve you in the way that bright principles and archetypal lineage can serve you in the world, because it can carry you in places where those other things don't even exist. And so it takes a couple of experiments, but you've already had enough experiments to radically rely on those resources. You already have. And so the shift from, like Susanna, what you said, that, you know, this small, bored, little crippled space of, you know, of can I do this or I don't know or whatever, like this terrified little space, the shift from that to this other game of invention and creation and service, something bigger than yourself, is a very small step. And so you're all capable of making that step. And I think the conversation is, can we support each other to just make that step? Because it's wanted and needed right now more than ever before in the world. And we've got a game world, a global game world ready for you to make that step. And if you crash and burn, you know, we'll all come to your funeral. No, really. I mean, you know, you've got friends who will come to your funeral. So that's the worst thing that could happen. And so, like, so what? Like, what else is going to happen? You got to try it. Okay, I'll shut up for a moment.
Along what you were saying, Aunt Chloe, about getting bored. Where is it that you're getting bored? I got this amazing pearl from Vera just the other day, where she said, create a life so delightful that you don't have time for anything else. And the anything else is basically the little drama. And I started asking that question, and And suddenly that space that you're talking about, Clinton, the small space, I can make the leap. And what I'm noticing is that I'm really turned on by the possibility team that just started yesterday with Sophia Vegele and holding space for women to go. Yes, 15 women were there, plus me and Sophia.
Yay.
I want to celebrate that. Yay.
Yes.
And I'm really happy about that. I'm really, really happy because women were really hungry for that and excited to be there together and asking questions. And that's where I'm finding delight. And the other place where I'm finding delight is being part of the game world and then having ideas, which are possibilities, like how can this game world improve? And I thought that I had to do all the possibilities that I was getting. I thought I was the one who had to do them. And so I had all these fires burning and I was letting them die because I cannot do them all. So now what I'm thinking is that probably I'll just get the possibilities and I'll just pass them on to someone. But then, I'm noticing that as I speak, I'm just thinking, okay, I want to do this. I want to go into a game world and check, okay, what is it not working? How can this be different? How can things go together? But then I don't know what's the next step? How do I create something where I go into a place and I do this? What is actually my speciality? What is that? Is it Game World Consultancy? So this is where I'm in need of a team. Where to go from here?
I don't have anything. Do you have something on?
Sonia, we got to live with you for a couple of months. And one of the kind of box strategies that you have is to light all these fires on fire and scatter yourself so that you're confused like this. And so you've been detecting this pattern in yourself before, but it's still obviously got you. If you were a guy, I would say it's got you by the balls, but because you're still asking that question as if it's real. And you know, you don't have to decide. Echo decides for you. Your archetypal lineage decides for you. And all you need to do is go, aye, aye, Captain. That's it, and move. And each moment along the way, you will get directed. So it's not your job to decide what to do next. It's right in front, you know, just go with the flow, like they say. You know, let the force be with you. Let the magnet pull you and trust the magnet. And like for me, I get fucking neurotic with certain things. Like right now, I'm fucking neurotic about finishing the afterword for this book. I've got like 10 pages left and I'm neurotic, but nothing else is interesting. You know, I blow off everything except it was my daughter's birthday today. And so I called her up and that I did that. So I didn't blow that off. But everything else, you know, breakfast, lunch, dinner, you know, chasing the giant ants that are flying into our room and, you know, filling up the room with dead ants and wings and all this stuff is going on around me. And it's like, I don't care. Because I'm neurotic about doing this thing. Is it a problem? Well, is it a problem?
No.
Okay, so it's not a problem.
No.
Okay, so that's the way. This is the way.
Thank you.
But not enough of you laughed when I said that, but oh well. You haven't seen The Mandalorian enough. Okay. Does that help, Sonia, what you're saying? What I'm saying?
Yes, it does.
Okay, so differentiate between your box doing its thing and confusing you, you know, which then you don't do anything and then you're safe, you know, which is the box's purpose. Or getting, you know, just like skipping that part and going, you just move. Move from your center, not from your head. Move from your center.
And I would add, in terms of a game world builder or game world maybe consultant perspective, is if you're getting, I heard it from Vera also, that if you, you know, if you're getting an idea and you're saying no to the idea will move on to the next person. Okay, but one of the ways, I mean, it could move on, you know, energetically, let's say, but one of the ways it also moves on is you say, there is this possibility. Somebody could take on that job. So I do that a lot in basically every spaces that I am, I said, you could do this, or this is possible, or there's a book that's missing there, or there's a connection that's missing there, or have you ever thought of this? And you drop all these seeds of ideas that you've received, but you're not doing them, so they're not for you.
I mean, I just want to add one thing onto that. Lately, I've been doing this left and right. And, you know, for example, I was just talking to Janet Redmond in New Zealand, and I said, when are you writing your book? You know, because she's got so much experience, this woman, from transactional analysis, from years of battling game world insanity, et cetera. And so she goes, well, and I go, okay, who's on your team for writing your book? And we open this up and she has five people on a team and a deadline for the manuscript. And every one of those people is excited for it. But what I did was not just drop a seed, but I created the group. I created the group for writing her book and put her in it. And I said, who could be in your group? She said, two or three people like that. So it's okay. You build out a little part of the game world that people can occupy, and it has enough of a framework that their mind can understand it. And then just fill it out. And then you use 0.5% of your attention to hold space for a while until the thing flies by itself. And that's what you can do. It's not just giving an idea. It's building up a little part of a game world that people can occupy. And then let it fly. How many? So I built 100 of those in the last year.
Yeah.
How many of them flew? I don't know, 8, 7 maybe. Okay, what happened to the rest of them? Well, they hit Box and Gremlin. They did not hit reality. They did not crash into reality because every single one of them was possible. But they crash into people's Box and Gremlin, not my responsibility. I build it out. I frame it up. People can occupy it. And then where does it go? It's not my problem. But enough of them work.
I mean, and now it's my problem.
What do you mean your problem?
Because I want to see them inhabited.
Ah.
I'm in this the back wheel or something trying to be, who's gonna occupy those?
So I don't know if you guys ever went fishing before, but a lot of people, when they go fishing, they take one hook, one fishing pole, one worm, and throw it out in one little pond, and then they wait. Okay, this is probably the story of your life. You are waiting with one hook in one pond and one worm for somebody to bite the hook and make you rich and famous, to be discovered. So I have about 80 hooks in 80 different ponds, and they're all sitting out there, and I don't have to do anything. I make the hook, I make the fishing line, I throw it in the pond, and I put it in the ground, and I wait. And I keep a little beeper, so if one starts going like this, I can respond. But most of them, nothing usually happens. But every now and then, we catch a big one. And it's just, it's great to have more than one hook in multiple ponds all at the same time without putting time and energy and attention in it that drives you crazy. You just build these things, throw them out there and wait. You have proposals and offers with all kinds of people all over the place. And when one hooks, you go with it 100% and you take it to the end. You take the thing to completion. It's published, it's created, it's built, it flies. People are holding space for it and it's flying.
There's legends.
The legends coming out, yeah. So this is straightforward to do. It's just a different form of fishing. It's not a net. It's not like you're throwing out a net, you know, where you're just going to try to catch everything. That's not it. You throw out one hook, one worm, one pond, and do it 80 times. See what happens.
Thank you.
Lisa, you're going to say something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel a bit of fear because it's King's Day here today and there's a lot of screaming in the background. So apologize if it comes in again. What I've been researching recently is really to do with this. And it's like, I called it creator's block. Like, what's stopping me from shifting space? Because I realized I really like to, Vera also pointed this out in the sexuality space. It's really easy to talk about something. And I find it really, I don't want to say difficult. I'm still like seeing what's stopping me from going from talking about it to actually just doing it instead of talking about it. So I've been experimenting and researching with that. Like what stops me from creating?
Stops me. What's the way through?
I think it's a lot of unconscious fear and getting stuck in not knowing how, like what you were saying. It's, Lisa, you don't need to know how.
Let me, Lisa Maria, right? Let me say something. Practice going more crazy. Practice, like Susanna's working on this too. Practice going more crazy because what you want to cause will not fit in your mind. It will not be rational. It will not be linear. It's invention. And you cannot occupy invention with your mind. So if you can allow yourself to go a little more crazy, and you have to do experiments with this. Put mustard on your scrambled eggs in the morning. You know, call up two people at the same time and talk to both of them at the same time. You write a poem in iambic pentameter. Figure out what iambic pentameter is, what Shakespeare did, and write your next article in iambic pentameter, which is Shakespeare style. Put on your bathing suit outside of your regular clothes and walk around. You know, tie a samurai belt around your head and stick feathers in it. You know, there's like, and I'm really, there's so many dimensions in which you can go crazier than you are right now. And each one that you experiment with will help you lower the walls of nonlinear possibility. Because what your archetypal lineage or echo is trying to offer you options to choose from, but you can't see them because you're locked into being sane and reasonable. And you cannot see the options that are being given to you right now. You cannot choose them. You can't go there because you've got this commitment to being reasonable or presentable or liked by others. But if you fart in public more, you know, if you put lipstick kind of all over your face the wrong way, as if you were drunk when you put your lipstick on and go for the whole day, make your calls, people go, what the heck are you doing with all that red smeared all over your face? And you go, what? What red? What? This is, I put it on today like this. Is there a problem? You know, like really allow yourself to be, go crazier in multiple dimensions that doesn't hurt people and doesn't hurt yourself. It's just opening doorways to nonlinear possibility so that the universe can talk to you in its language, not in your language. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a question about the 80 hooks in the 80 ponds. What is the difference to having 80 pots on the fire, like 80 fires going?
Divides up your energy. Do you want to say something?
If you have pots on the fire, you have to check if they burn or not.
All the time.
They're burning.
It's using up your whole energy. The hooks don't use up any energy, hardly at all. They have, if it starts to move, it talks to you. Otherwise, nothing's going to happen. It does not use up your time, energy, and attention to have a hook in the water.
Okay.
You get it?
I do.
Cool.
And I would, this is another dimension. I mean, you know, what we're talking about in terms of these 80 hooks in the water is Let me see. It's like you're opening new territories for other people to move into. And then if they move into, you care for that. You're with them, you know, you give them what they need, the consulting that they need, and then you let them fly. So that's one dimension of game world building. But for example, there's another dimension where you are the source person for the game world. Like without you, the game world does not exist. And it can be such something like Archiarchy Freiburg. So that's a game world. And we have the two main spaceholders in the space right here. And if Marcus and Eva take their attention away from Archiarchy Freiburg, the thing dies. Again, it is no more energy. Because as of now, what my experience is, Eva and Marcus are the source people. And then there's this, question, you know, and it can start with a three cell, or it can even start with, let's take the example of a three cell. What I want to say is that you probably have baby game worlds that you are already part of. Maybe you have a three cell, maybe you have a possibility team, maybe it's just a collaboration, maybe it's just yourself. I think you have game worlds, you already have a seed of game world in each one of you, but it's how do you nourish it? How do you bring it to life? And then there's this question, you know, the next step is basically game worlds need teams. Okay, well, how do you bring teams really alive so they don't die on our ordinary survival, trying to be safe with other people and our inability to radically relate with other human being, you know, at this edge of craziness that Clinton was talking about to Lisa and also Sonia, is building a game world and like evolving a game world is living at the edge of crazy, where you're doing the impossible, you're thinking about the impossible and sourcing the impossible of things like people never thought of before.
So I just want to say it slightly different from what Chloe is saying, one sentence, which is figure out ways to feed your people in unusual ways. Figure out ways to feed your people in unusual ways. And one of those ways is to offer challenges, is to invent adventurous, edgy, possible challenge experiences that they would not normally do. Their box would not normally do it. Their mom would not let them do it. You know, they could not do it in school, so of course they can't do it in their life. But you're offering these challenges for people to, and these can be like a hooks in the water. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, write this article, show, you know, challenge, go meet, have a meeting with this game world, you know, make this proposal to somebody else, you know, all these challenges, produce this video for yourself, you know, 3-minute video, put it online about this, answering this question, give a work talk about this. You know, each one of these challenges will be something they didn't think of, but if they do it, it puts them in a liquid state that brings people together. And when people come together from the liquid state, this is called the thing about the, it's called a break in certainty. It's a way to, in your team, you put in a challenge that causes a crack in certainty. So the box looks at the world as if it is the box's world. Do you get that? The box looks around and sees what it sees and the possibility that it can perceive. And it goes, okay, this is how the world really is. But it's not like that. The box is a giant filter and it filters out all these other possibilities. So when you put a, when you give a challenge, it puts a crack in the box of certainty, and all of a sudden people come more alive. They get some fresh air. And in that liquid state of this crack in certainty, that people connect and get connected in new ways, and they get fed in new ways. And so this is a way to provide food for your people in unusual ways. And this is a skill. You can develop that skill to absurd levels of effectiveness.
But
I remember I remember
thing is that it requires being an asshole.
What?
It requires actually being an asshole, because you'll have, there will be all sorts of reaction from the box of, I can't do this.
It's impossible. It's not nice. My mother wouldn't let me.
You know, and to get it that you're committing to their liquid state that will let this being come out. And the roar of the box, you could, you know, put the red cuff on the side, make a black hole. And it doesn't matter. Whatever excuses you're coming up with right now, I'm not talking to that part. And it's being an asshole to not believe in people's victim story. So I did that recently with Sonia, where I just said, look, I don't believe you. I don't believe your bullshit swamp. She never answered me, but my friends. So. Marcus.
Yeah, I wanted to say that from my own experience, it's been revolutionary to have people around me, and like many of here are some of them, who challenged me and opened doorways where I could actually notice, oh, this is how powerful I am. And so getting these challenges, I want to admit that they were very healing. Like they're part of healing offers also in terms of transformation, because in the past, my box, as you said it right now, my box didn't believe I was able to do that. And it's so cool for me. Still, it's so revolutionary to have found groups and people who say that's what we do with each other.
How are you doing passing it forward, Marcus?
I'd say not enough. And I am also doing it. Yeah, I'm learning it here in the community in Freiburg, where I live. It's part, and also in Freiburg with some people who train with me.
And what about the possibilitator training Dach, for example? I want to say something about that.
Yes.
Because there's a... It's like your being is probably bigger than other people's being in your community or in the Archiarchy Freiburg, because you're the space holder, which would mean that your being in that domain is basically bigger. And so there's something about giving challenges to people with a not as radiant being that is almost easier than to meet peers at that level and to give challenges to your peers so that they might become more powerful, more radiant, bigger than you, that the challenge would make them surpass you. Mm-hmm. And that was that. I think that's the possibility that's open in the Dach.
Mm-hmm.
But the purpose is that people become better than whatever. Not better, but like, do you get what I'm saying? More radiant, more powerful, more empowered.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I remember that I've been stumbling around this question, how to do this, multiple times already. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not the question about how.
Mm-hmm.
It's about doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are all kinds of people to do that with. I oftentimes connect with my peers and make such proposals. And the problem, one of the problems that I encounter is this handsome, holy tribal man addiction. You know, it's a defended position. It's a survival strategy to be something. And these guys, mostly guys, try to be a thing. And then I make this proposal that would take them off that pedestal and throw them into this transformational process, liquid state of doing something they don't know how to do already. They don't know who to be that thing. And so I meet their defenses. And the point is, I'm standing outside their wall going, hey, and it freaks them out because their wall is supposed to be everything. supposed to be what modern culture wants, you know, the ideal. And if somebody stands outside of that and goes, you're in a prison, buddy, you're trapped in there. What if you come out and play? This freaks them out. And so not very many will open the door or step outside their thing to join the invitation. But so what? It creates legends. It opens, I don't know, maybe 5 years from now, somebody will come around. But it's like, just do it anyway. Even if it's obvious, it will be rejected or not understood. Just do it anyway. See, I think, Marcus, you're trying to figure out how to do it with a guaranteed success. And I suggest you do it with a guaranteed failure. I suggest a new strategy. Go out and fail. Fail boldly, daringly. Just fail in public and splash yourself all over the, you know, sidewalk. It's a new strategy.
Yeah.
Fail boldly.
And to not leave the possibilitator training. Ah.
You say more
you
about
said that?
Christine.
Go ahead.
I said, and not to leave the possibilitator training, Dach. As you said yesterday, Marcus.
Because?
Because I don't believe you. When you say you want to stay with us, when we practice another context, but you're not staying with us when we stay with the context of possibility management. That's what you said yesterday.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's four of you with a line in the script right now, and you're afraid to be crazy to speak out in a space like this. You can put your hands up, the four of you. Just put your hands up. One, two. Who's the other two?
Two people smiling? The people smiling? It's you.
So Marin's one of them, and Katrin. You guys should have your hands up and you don't have them up even. But we can all see that you have a light in the script. You're just not going for it. This is a place where you can fail boldly.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
To fail, yes.
Keep going.
Okay. My discovery from the last year is really to stay with, to fail. And to stay I felt very touched about the things you share, because
who's the you,
Clinton and Aunt Chloe and the other people here in the space which has been spoken, because it's not more, it's I could let go the story that I have to reach a goal or something like that. And the discovery from the last year has been to stay in the state of wandering, to wandern, to make a march. And and it's more about, what's my next question? What is the next thing to, what is my next challenge? Where is the space to be more alive? Where I can reach more fear, where I can reach more anger? Where are the parts I missed in my life? And I realized that the more I would go my path without knowing how I make it, and there is no big topic that I am special in something. It is that going that way, it will be interesting for other people, because they see the change, and they see And that's really touched me. If you started in the beginning, if you said the world will open, the game world will open if you really go there. And I realize if I am in a situation to solve a situation or to practice mm-hmm. with a situation, it's not difficult. It's only there is a situation, there are possibilities, okay, I can change it, and then I can go further. It's not about to stuck in the situation, it's more about where is the next question. Mm. So I love to fail now.
Yay!
and I want to share, one of the part I realized it was I don't know, it wasn't a TED talk or something like that, about the one person of Monty Python, and he talked about what is about creativity, and if you want to be creative, you couldn't stay in a position where something could be wrong. Everything must be right. Is it? There's nothing wrong there. And that was really mind shifting for me.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The Christina, you said something to Marcus and about the possibilitator training Dach, and I wanted to hear from you, Marcus. What do you have to say about that?
I think this is not the space for that conversation. It would be a different space.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Actually, you bit a hook, and the hook would go into kind of a low drama direction. So this is a different conversation.
Eva, you muted.
Muted. I feel fear to say this because because I've noticed something. I realized something, and I feel fear because it doesn't fit into my concept of what possibility management is. So I'm also glad about that. But I noticed that I am an Archan food planter, an Archan food grower,
and
because I'm totally neurotic about growing food, like it's really taking overhand. I can't stop myself. And I've been living in this conflict. What is that? Oh, an avocado.
Can't stop myself either.
So that's how nomads grow food. And while I listened to you talking and, you know, 80 ponds and the 80 hooks, I noticed that I want to empower other people to grow food. And that is part of Archiarchy Freiburg. And yeah. I've been living a few weeks or months in this conflict of, well, maybe I should be writing my next Rage Club article, but if I'm true to what I really want, I want to go out and plant and sow and shovel 1.5 tons of compost. That's what I really want. And so that will, yeah, I'm bringing that together. That's my speciality for the next months too. And that's also where it fits together with why I want to empower people to exchange concrete for compost.
Yeah. If it will help you if you say that's what a part of me wants.
Yeah.
Okay, because you say that's what I really want, then that's all, that's the end of your story. You'll be a gardener and we'll have really nice vegetables over in Freiburg, you know, and you'll have some friends who are growing squash and zucchini and beans, you know, and that will be the end of your story. But if you say this is what a part of me wants, then you get it's part of your game world then. Do you see the difference?
Yeah, that's why I'm like so afraid, because I know there's also...
But just
say
it. I also
want to have a next Good Go Busters training. I also want to create trainings and deliver Rage Club. I want all of that.
So don't skip the all of it part. because all of it is a fantasy world. All of it is this feminine gone crazy world. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help anybody. So what you just get is that you have parts, you know, and you can have 3, 4, 5 parts functioning in different game worlds at the same time. And, you know, don't just get it that you have these parts, and don't give one thing more power over the other. Let your parts, a few of your parts, thrive.
And more than that is,
don't get identified with one part. So don't say, this is what I want. The universe lists shit like that, and you're going to be just shoveling compost the rest of your life.
No, but it's more than that is that how a good girl cannot destroy asphalt.
Mm-hmm.
A good girl cannot have the authority to get out of the supermarket game world.
Yeah.
And so that you are neurotic about gardening is feeding your good girl Buster game world, yeah, and Rage Club Buster. Or in So it seems like it's a conflict, and consider that they're not conflicting, that they're feeding each other.
Yeah.
And then you'll have parts. And then you'll have more energy, because all the energy that you're spending into your conflict, you can put it in something else.
You need to write a little article that says, I have parts.
Okay.
These are my game.
While shoveling compost, you can record it.
Yes.
There's a game world called Archan Permaculture. Do you know about that? Ever?
Yeah, I only know that Gabrielle is playing in that game world. I don't know who else.
There's a Telegram group and it's pretty active. There's a couple guys in New Zealand who are really, they're moving into, you know, like regional, how to bring whatever, organic, farm grown, forget the
supermarket. James.
Yes.
I'm in that group.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, one great thing while I was like spreading the compost, I was like processing this. Like, I had this other identity with me too. And that told me that, or I found while I was doing that, that these gardens have bright principles. And the bright principles of these Archan food gardens are abundance, collaboration, simplicity.
And there's one other bright principle called compost yourself.
Transformation.
The website.
Transformation. Compost. Probably.
It needs content. Ava, we need content about compost yourself.
Okay.
So what, you know, then the conversation that can become interesting in the possibilitator training or with your game world consultant is, what's the next step for the game world? Because right now, basically,
you have two
gardens. You just have more people than gardens, you know. So
but I'm
how are you gonna get the people? You know, and the people are already out there. There is this thing called Archan Food Garden. You know, and we're meeting at the garden once a week. And I'm telling you about the bright principles, I'm telling you about, you know, the culture that goes around, you know, the energetic culture and the whatever, the agriculture or whatever, the permaculture that goes into it.
Thank you.
I want to be part of that team, Eva.
Yay.
And you can connect with me because I'm on the next step, which is the like creating from the abundance of the gardens some delicious foods.
Yay.
So I'm on the homesteading side, like pickling. Archan pickling.
Archan pickling, yay.
I know about Mariola. She's also a food creator and very interested in this. Thank you.
Thank you. Sabina, keep talking.
Yes. So one part of me is
is it's all about relating. So I found out that the year before we made a workshop and it was about living relationships, and then we found out we have to start with a relationship with myself. And in the last year I can say I related to myself and found the love in me, and I found the source. And now I step out of the war inside of me, and also the war between me and others. So I'm ready to go for this now, to really speak about or work with people about relationship and going into relationship. That's a topic of mine.
Yay.
Yay.
Possibility coaching relationship.
Yes.
What Clinton is saying is it needs a name. It needs a name so we can talk about it. It needs a name so when I meet somebody who says, I'm at war with myself, I say, do you know this game world? Because I would rather give the energy to the game world than saying, do you know Sabine? Because then it gives the energy to one person. But the moment you decide that, you know, this is a chapter that's complete in your life and you're moved on to the next thing, then that place, that territory disappears with you disappearing, basically. But if you build a game world, somebody else can take over the game world, and the energy keeps going. It remains a brick in the path, like a step.
You replace yourself.
Yes. Yeah.
So what would be the name? What's the name?
So nourishing relationships, or from me to me, or
it's a little bit long.
Me to me.
From me to me.
Anyway, thank you.
From me to meat.
No, this is a vegetarian conversation. Eva, come on.
No, it's not meat. It's meat, other people.
Encounter.
Double E.
Double E.
Okay, so think about it, Sabine. The name for the game world, so that you can train other people, people can play in it, people can write an article within that game world and give it life.
Yes.
Great.
Sophia, you're thinking about something and you're not saying it. So we need your contribution.
Few things going on right now. First of all, I thought just now about how can I, you said this from me to we. I thought about it yesterday with the Archan Pathwalkers, that I want, like, sometimes I have this sense that the lights are on me as a space holder. But then it's that then, and I thought it's just like it is. It's just how it is when I'm a space holder. And I talked to Michael about it, and he said, but then it's about me. And it's like, and I feel sad about it, because I want the space actually to have the light on, not the light on me, but this, that the space is not yet delighted, like Sonia said, and just, with this light on in everyone, so that we can, that everyone shines. And this is not, it will not be possible when I keep on thinking that the light's on me as a space holder. So I just, like, I'm starting to, in this call, I start to sense that something in me needs to shift to be able to be with my team differently, basically. And then this question opens for me, okay, so then what is next? Because I don't want a coffee space in the Archan Pathwalkers where we just are with each other. But what is really next? And how can I, yeah, surf with the fear of I don't know what is next for these people. And I cannot keep asking, or I don't want to spend 15 minutes in the beginning asking everyone, what is next for you? What is next for you? What is, what is the space about? So.
So if you ask somebody what's next for them, who answers?
Probably, first of all, the box.
Yes. Bad answer. We learned this thing last year, which is that if, as a space holder, you're putting your attention on the bright principles, you're looking at the bright principles, this is traditional
enlightenment.
This is traditional Eastern spiritual practice. Put your attention on the deities, put your attention on the source, put your attention on the light, okay? Then what happens is you block the light from the space. You block it. And the bright principles off to no end. They're just pissed off because they don't want you to look at them. They want you to turn around, put your back to them, and let them use your eyes. And you look at the people, and you don't have to know what they want because the bright principles already know what they want. They know what the next step is for them. And it's probably not what they want. It's the next step for people is mostly not what they want because it's a liquid state. It is transformation. It is healing. It is evolution. And so let the bright principles do its work by not looking at them.
By being backlighted.
You get back, instead of being enlightened, you get backlighted. Backlightenment. Backlightenment. And it's a big thing because most people are trained. We're trained to look at God, look at the bright, look at all, you know, oh, you're so big. I'm so small. It's a quote from Monty Python. Anyway. Yeah, you get this? We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see if you get it. You just look at people and start talking and let the bright principles tell people what the next thing is. Don't ask them. Just don't ask.
So, and probably then you should join the team of Lisa and Susanne about being crazy.
Yeah.
Because you will not recognize yourself when those things starts pouring in all different ways.
Say it again. She didn't get it.
I heard you. I will probably not recognize myself when these things start talking through me.
Therefore.
And therefore, I should join Lisa and Susanne's team of going crazy, which
yes.
then would be a three cell.
Yes.
Yes.
Crazy asshole three cell. Crazy asshole three
yeah.
cell.
Yeah.
Sophia, are you in my three cell about going crazy?
Yes. I am.
Lisa, will you be in my three cell going crazy?
Ah!
Okay, that's a deal.
Yes.
Ingrid, I really want to hear what you have to say, and I know that that's difficult right now. And so I can hear your soul speaking a lot in here. And so thank you for speaking out without using words. Thank you. It's really nice. Thank you for participating.
My specialty is there is not such a thing as disease. There are conditions you have to deal with in any given moment, but there is not such a thing as disease. Everybody who is visiting me gets it. Not every box gets it.
Yay. Wow, thank you. Way cool.
Thank you, Ingrid.
Wow.
Thank you.
You could have the voice sing for you. It'd be nice. Soprano, I think. Isabel.
And Catherine, you also didn't say what you were going to say.
I realized that I'm a little bit frozen and I feel sad. And my edge is things I like and I have a fire for it turns into a burden. And even though I am, yeah, I went out of the prison of working, but my life still has this quality of, I need to do so much. I don't have time for myself. And I realize that I'm in this division of free time and not free time. And
Catherine, it doesn't really matter, but what you're saying is that you're just entering your journey of radical freedom.
Yes.
Just starting your journey of radical freedom.
Do you know what that is?
Not really.
There's a website. There's a really great, fantastic website with a brilliant work talk from Gabriela Fagundes that was in the Archiarchy Makers Fair called Radical Freedom. You can listen to it on the website. It's not a rule or anything, but I found that the journeys of radical freedom usually work better and deeper when you get out of your usual environment. I mean, physical environment. Because the physical environment, you know, you wake up, you know where the coffee is, you know where to get the food, and then your computer's there, and you know the people, and it's all just these huge grooves. And if you're in a culture where you don't speak the language and they don't have brown toast and butter for breakfast, who are you? You know, what are you going to do?
We don't even know if we should put the toilet paper down the toilet or in the basket right now. It's a confusing world, and it's groundless enough that possibilities flow through here like a thunderstorm.
So until you get to this radical freedom space, you'll be stuck in the burden thing and the work.
Katrin and Chloe are saying hit the road. What does that look like for you?
Grab my backpack and go somewhere. I'm considering
outside of Europe.
And outside of Europe.
Come to Brazil to the Women's Bridge House.
Yay!
For a year.
Or as long as it allows.
Could be.
You see, we're doing this kind of experiment. I don't know if she knows.
I didn't understand everything.
So right now, there's a Women's Bridge House happening in Brazil. That's where I am, Veris, and also Alice Bells. And Lisa Maria will join, and Jacqueline O'Neill. And I am inviting you to come here and do radical freedom experiments with us. No.
Thank you.
Our internet connection is not that awesome right now.
Katrin, you don't do it. You have to eat farofa. this wild stuff called farofa.
Yes, I realize I only have, but there is a lot of stories occurring, and I will go through the website and I will connect with you, Sonia and Vera, and I'm already in contact with Marina for the bridge house in Cap Verde.
Yay. Mm-hmm.
That's a single mom's bridge house, isn't it?
No, so anybody. Ah. Any woman, I think. Men are not invited.
Beings.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have a few more minutes, Isabel.
Yes, right now. I'm standing on the edge, building game worlds right here, right now in Freiberg, and not in the world around, because I'm in many places. I went to Minden, to Nicole Anya, and there was a game world in this moment, and this functioned. My edge is to do it behind the door of my flat here in this town. And what's landing right now is not to have this concept of what PM has to do. Better to go with what is living in me, something like crocheting with energy, something in the winter, and not doing it alone, and do it with others. And it's not crocheting like I know from my grandma. It's something different because the energy is in it. Or I have this pain because there are so many, there's so big magic things in me, and I don't know how to bring them here in Freiberg right out.
Yes. Isabel, let one of those speak. You're holding back right now. Like, let the thing speak even before you know how it goes, okay? Let one of those things speak to us, okay? Just now, just start letting it speak.
Yes, I have one of these parts in me going with the sword, and this is so magic to go with this. And
what is it?
To bring this sword to the women, this great warrior inside, and to go aufgerichtet, to go
upright
and straight. Mm-hmm. And I yes, and there's something to do it in Freiberg without knowing, and to bring it with me and go through the streets and with the sword, and yes, and to go crazy with this. And I'm so afraid to do this because it's like one of my box will fall apart, because they, maybe the people here getting to know another Isabel than I am in all the teams where I'm going with the sword, and it's so magic what happens there. And I want it here in Freiberg, out of the door, and there are so many gremlins and such a, oh, yes. And
so, Isabel, you could get a box, you know, a box, like a big plastic box or wooden box, and put it in the middle of the park, one of the parks or downtown near the big church, and you stand on it with your sword, and you refuse to be hooked by the gremlins, and you don't stop talking, but you don't be hooked. People will make comments or ask questions, and you roll with what?
Even have looks or chuckles or...
Yeah, and you just keep talking about what's possible for women with a sword in their life, in the world. It's needed. It's coming out. It's happening. Mm-hmm. And you represent that possibility, but you don't get hooked. You don't have to answer anybody's question. You don't have to respond to any comments. You just look at them and say the next thing, but don't say Don't go through the door they open up. Go through the door that you need to go through, that your sword, let your sword talk. Let your sword talk. What would you do that?
I am on your team.
Me too.
Yes, and I want to create this crazy going team here too in Freiberg, on the streets of Freiberg.
Make some cards, you know, and if people are interested, you just give them a card and say, you know, I'm just standing here announcing, opening a door. Here's a card. Talk to me, you know, and go talk to the next person, you know, and just keep and have start having a sword team, a women's sword team or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. I need this because this I have this box of what PM is, and I need this nonlinear ideas because there are so much, and I'm going for this nonlinear possibilities because there are so much, and I need thank this. You. I need this connection to PM because there is something, and I often say I want to do this different, and sometimes it looks like there's only a gremlin and I don't want this, but this isn't it. I feel that it's something different. It yes.
I look, Marin's on your team, Susanna's on your team,
yes.
Sabina's on your team, Christina. So just talk to them, just like go, okay, I'm doing it. You just do it. Maybe all of them can do it at the same time.
Yeah.
Saturday morning, you all go out with a sword and a box and a card, and you just start talking. And you let the sword talk. You let the sword talk, not you, not your box. Just let the sword talk, and don't be hooked by anybody. Just keep talking.
And get yourself a space holder for yourself. Don't do it alone.
And you did it already on the 29th of December, remember, in the woods, you did it already.
I know.
So just go.
Go.
You can do this.
Thank you.
You can do it. Anybody, last words, a couple more minutes. Somebody need to say anything?
Yeah, I have a question about what you said already to Eva about this I want it all crazy woman thing. Can you say just a few more things about that? Because when I hear you all talk, a part of me wants that all. Wants to be in the crazy three cell, wants to create with Eva in the garden, wants to go to the bridge house, the women's bridge. So
what? Sophia, that's it's like you make it personal. It's like about what you would want as like Sophia, and because you can be everything, like, so you know, I mean, that's why women flip through magazines. It's like, God, what can I be today? Because it, you know, I can be this person in the garden, you know, and there's a part of you that would be turned on by that, or by the sword, or by, and you have an archetypal lineage, and you have bright principles who have preference. And that's what I found so powerful in Game World Building, is that I can be in the garden because Eva's in the garden. So I'm not in the garden, but there, that possibility of being in the garden exists because Eva is there. Okay, but what is my job? You know, what turns me on? You know, what do I wake up in the morning and, like Clinton said, I can't do anything else. Everything else explodes.
It's not me. It's what turns on my
archetypal lineage. Yeah.
Say it again.
Yeah. So what turns on my archetypal lineage is what I do. You know, that's how I know. It's like, where do I put my attention on?
And your box might freak out.
Where did my archetypal lineage put my attention on?
Hmm.
What is the questions that my archetypal lineage has? Or who does it want to connect with? And so, and that gives me this ongoing impulses, but I can't make sense of it.
You don't have to.
Like Clinton said, I don't have to, but it's, that's how the everythingness comes alive. is that your archetypal lineage will give you jobs that don't fit in one identity.
You know, my mother would come to me and say, what are you doing? You have a degree in physics, you know, and what are you doing with your life? And I go, I'm reinventing modern culture. And it was like, what does that mean? What job is that on the tax form? And it is not a job on the tax form. You know, it's like I'm serving my archetypal lineage. She goes, what does that mean? You know, it doesn't even know what it means. I go, Mom, good question. I mean, when you figure it out, what it means, you tell me. Okay, so it's let your archetypal lineage lead. Sophia, what happens when you think about that?
What happens when I think about it, when I hear this, is that it's time to not map onto what other people do or what other people bring, and when how that is, even if it excites me.
It can excite you, mm-hmm. but it doesn't mean going there. You didn't answer the question. What is it actually happens to you when you have the sense of letting your archetypal lineage lead?
Right now I feel sad.
Because
I want, like, I want this, or I don't know what my sadness is. I
think you just like feeling sad. Look, if you want this, then by next time we talk, tell us what happened when you let your archetypal lineage lead.
Okay.
Like, sit there until your archetypal lineage tells you to go somewhere else. It comes from your center, not from your mind. Try it as an experiment. How many people will try this experiment? Starting now, let your archetypal lineage move you from your center and go crazy. And don't try to worry about it. Okay, and don't go to jail. Okay, stay out of jail. That's number three.
That's it.
Okay, that's it. Susanna, you're saying the last words?
I will do this experiment to go crazy and let my archetypal lineage lead. And I will.
Yes!
Guys, Sutsuma. Bye bye. Nice to talk to you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.